Now, let's talk a little bit about asymmetric encryption. We have for thousands of years used symmetric encryption, where both the sender and receiver have the same key, but asymmetric encryption is a very young technology, at least compared to symmetric. We have used asymmetric encryption for practical purposes for maybe 40-50 years. Compared to the thousands of years that we have used symmetric encryption, it's not that long. So in the 1970s, multiple different types of asymmetric encryption was developed. That includes Diffie-Hellman from 1976, RSA, which was named after its developers just like Diffie-Hellman, Rivest, Shamir, and Edelman, and RSA was published in 1977. Another key difference here between symmetric and asymmetric encryption is that for each person or each entity we have with asymmetric encryption, we need two keys. If we have 500 users, we need 1,000 keys. If we have 1,000,000 users, we need 2,000,000 keys. So the math here is pretty simple. Whereas with symmetric encryption, for each pair that needs to communicate, you need one key. But if that is the same 500 people that needed the 1,000 asymmetric keys, with symmetric keys, they would need 124,750 keys. Because each of those 500 people will need 499 keys to communicate with everybody. With asymmetric encryption, we encrypt with one key and we decrypt with the other. Let's say that I'm gonna send you a message and I want it to be only read by you. Well, then I get your public key. That is a key that is available to everybody. Everybody can see that key. And the keys work in a pair. You need both for it to function. And they are asymmetric, meaning they're not the same. So I encrypt the message with your public key. The only way to decrypt that message is using your private key. You keep that secret. Now, if anyone else were to intercept that message that was encrypted with your public key, they can't do anything with that because they don't have your private key. They can't decrypt the message. And that really is the reason why asymmetric encryption is so nice. We can send messages over an unsecure medium like the internet without having that pre-shared key that we would with symmetric encryption. Because that really has been the problem with symmetric encryption. How do we agree on whatever we're using as the secret key, that shared secret? How do we agree on what size of stick we use? How do we agree on how many letters we switch it back for the Caesar cipher? How do we agree on which book we use for the book cipher, in which version? We need a way to share that information. With asymmetric, we don't have that problem. But this is also why it is so important that you keep your private key secure. If that gets compromised, if an attacker gains access to the key, well, then they can read all your messages. Now, let's say that I sent that message to you. You read it. Now you want to respond. Well, then you use my public key, just like I used yours with the message I sent to you. You use my public key to encrypt the reply. I use my private key to decrypt it. Since I only have my private key, no one else does, I'm the only one that can read the reply. Does that make sense? And if not, just logic through it a couple of times. We can also use asymmetric encryption for digital signatures. And here the order is slightly in reverse. When we use asymmetric encryption, the point is to keep our secret secret. It's focused on the confidentiality leg of the CIA triad. But when we use digital signatures, well then we want authenticity and we want non-repudiation. We want to be able to prove that that email came from whoever sent it or whomever signed that document. We may or may not need the confidentiality at all. And since the point here is the authenticity and the non-repudiation, in that case, if I send you a message, I encrypt it with my private key. Since I am the only one who has my private key, well then you know that message came from me, because you can decrypt it with my public key. That of course in no way provides confidentiality. That's not the point of it. We want authenticity and we want non-repudiation. But let's pretend we want both. If we want the authenticity, we want the non-repudiation, but we also want the confidentiality. If you want, you can pause the lecture here for a minute and think, how would we do that? If you don't, well, then don't. So assuming you stopped the lecture, welcome back. If not, well then hello again. So with my message, I want non-repudiation, I want authenticity, and I also want confidentiality. How do we do that? And the answer here again is private and public keys. We really do it both ways around. I want to be able to prove that message came from me, so I use my private key. But I also want only you to decrypt that message. Well, then I use your public key. So I encrypt it with my private key, then I encrypt that ciphertext with your public key, so it gets encrypted twice. Then when you get it, you decrypt it with your private key, since you are the only one who has that, you're the only one who can read the message. And then you decrypt again using my public key. That way, we ensure that only you can read it, and we can prove it came from me. If it doesn't make sense, logic your way through it a couple of times, understand the flow, and think about how we use public and private keys. I use my private key to encrypt. That can be decrypted by anyone because my public key is in the public domain. But I also use your public key on top of my private key. That means only you can decrypt it. Does that make sense? Now, for the actual data we send over the internet, we really use hybrid encryption because both symmetric and asymmetric have things they're really good at. Asymmetric is good about sharing the keys over the unsecured medium, the internet. Symmetric encryption is awesome about sending data fast, but we need to be able to share that key, the symmetric key, before we can start the fast data transfer. Asymmetric encryption can help us do that. So we use asymmetric encryption first, that establishes the session and shares the key. Then for the actual data transfer, we use symmetric encryption. And then in many places, we would also have a re-authentication ever so often using asymmetric and maybe a new key. And with that, we are done with this lecture. Thank you for being here, and I will see you in the next one.